that can look at solving problems, or at least providing a fire, or at least igniting the solution towards the problems that we have. So with that, I think I don't have anything more to say, but I'd be happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Vinay. You mentioned the challenges of attracting capital. I think, before I go to Ern, Shumita, you mentioned also how difficult it was to attract the startup capital. As your organization has grown over the years, have you found it, has the environment changed? Has your ability to access capital changed? Can you tell us a little bit about that?
I think it's changed. In fact, I think it's changed quite dramatically in the last 5 years, or maybe I'm just more aware, and I wasn't aware 5 years ago where to look. But 5 years ago, it was really difficult, and if Vineet from Avishkar didn't have the faith in us, I don't know whether we'd have been able to take that leap. But I think it has changed. It's changing for the better, and I think that's a real positive change.
Great, that's good to hear. Ern, maybe you can tell us a little bit about what you're doing at Impact Investment Exchange and how that seeks to play a role in sustainable development.
Sure, Rob. I think before I go specifically in who we are, what we do, I think the general comment I like to make is just from today's panel, you can see that poverty is a multifaceted challenge, right? It goes all the way from providing basic needs, sanitation, healthcare, energy, sustainability, you know, and it really ties into something that Bart mentioned when the United Nations came up with the 8 sort of Millennium Development Goals. I mean, that was targeted at addressing poverty through everything from, you know, healthcare, gender equality to HIV. So I think if we step back for a moment and realize that, you know, from what the panelists that you hear today, that poverty is a big problem. Now, just on that precursor, how it relates to what we are trying to do is we found that there are many, many social entrepreneurs, like the two up on stage today, in Asia, and they're all seeking to do good things. Now, how we wanted to contribute to the pot of solutions out there was providing them access to capital. We felt, we really felt strongly that there was so much capital floating out there. But the issue was directing that capital into the places like Asia, but not only to Asia in the top pile, but to the base of the pyramid. And we found that this whole concept of this birth of the social enterprise model really helped us in channeling that capital to the people that really need it on the ground. So that's really the starting premise for which we founded, the team was created. We're called Impact Investment Exchange Asia. We're a team based in Singapore. We are very fortunate to be supported by the Asian Development Bank, Rockefeller Foundation, and the Singapore Economic Development Board. So essentially what the team tries to do is we're trying to create two capital raising platforms to help social entrepreneurs like Vinay and Shumita basically scale up to magnify their impact, whether it be energy, whether it be through artisanal empowerment, through job creation, and the list goes on. So let me tell you a little bit about the two platforms that we are seeking to create. We essentially have a private platform and a public platform. The private platform is called Impact Partners, and we recently launched that in the end of March. And we are also working towards launching the public platform, which is called Impact Exchange, which we hope will come live in the second quarter of next year. Now, essentially what, Impact Partners is, it's a private online platform that tries to connect impact investors with social entrepreneurs all around Asia Pacific. Now, essentially the premise is this, you know, I mentioned earlier, there's so many investors out there that basically range from high net worth individuals, family offices, foundations, companies, and social venture funds. They're all out there. It's about channeling that capital to social entrepreneurs with innovative and sustainable business models all around Asia. So essentially, and just to clarify, although the term social enterprise is used quite a lot, for our purposes, it really includes both for-profit and non-profit social enterprises that basically have a social or environmental mission that can range from anywhere from healthcare, sanitation, clean technology, all the way to microfinance. So essentially, it's a very wide ocean. Now, if I just talk a little bit about how that relates to Impact Exchange is the public platform that we're seeking to launch next year. It's meant to be a fully regulated trading platform where social entrepreneurs can raise both equity and debt funding through our exchange. And many of you will ask, so why a stock exchange? Why a social stock exchange? And I think that the key point is that there are plenty of stock exchanges out there. They're very effective mechanisms for raising capital. Why we conceptualize a social stock exchange is because we're not just wanting to give capital to social entrepreneurs. We want to give them mission-aligned capital, which is consistent with what their mission and their strategy. So the public platform tries to do that by creating not just financial listing criteria, but also social and environmental listing criteria. So when you raise capital, this so-called triple bottom line return, people, planet, profit, is key to you. And that's really what, you know, what we seek to do.
Great. Thank you, Aaron. What I want to make sure we have time for the roundtable discussions and hear feedback from everyone. I will open it up now for a few questions if people have them for the panelists. Otherwise, we can move straight away into the roundtable discussion. Yes.
Does someone have a mic? Oh, the mic. One up front.
My name is Krishan Khanna. We run a nonprofit. It's about 19 years old. And we are working, of course, only within India. We have noticed, we work on livelihoods, we work on employment, we work on education. We also work on business and governance. And we have, this is our own conclusion, which we wanted to bounce it off you and the other experts on the panel and get your feedback. We feel that one of the biggest challenges for poverty alleviation and bringing people out of that is education and vocational training and primary healthcare. If one could stick to these three areas, a lot of other things will fall into place. Now, we wanted your opinion on that, because we have looked at a number of areas in India where this is happening and people are bouncing out of poverty very quickly. And where it's not happening, I think it's going to take a long time. It's no use pumping in money if you can't educate the people. You know, it's like giving farmer loans, but not giving them vocational training.
Thank you. That's a very good observation. I wonder whether we're experts, or I think maybe you're the expert on that, but maybe I'll turn it over if anyone wants to comment, Shumita, from your experience in the field.
I can attempt that because, when I worked in the NGO, which started in 1986, many years ago, we started off with exactly this premise that, providing primary health care and education would solve a lot of the problems. And this was actually funded then by a farmers cooperative, the Urmul Dairy, an affiliate of the Amul Dairy. It was people's money, and they put it in education and health. But the next year, there was this devastating drought, and that just ruined all the dairy milk production in that area. And we realized that everything is connected, actually. Everything is interconnected. I mean, in the sense that if education for what? Unfortunately, traditionally in our country, fortunately, it's changing, but traditionally, it has been people want to educate their children so that they get a nokri. Service, ideally in the government, which doesn't happen, as teachers, which would never then teach in the schools, or as lab assistants in medical health centers who never function. So the whole, I mean, education is very important and it's all very linked, but I think it's all linked together in the sense of how, you know, what is the need in the market, what kind of education do we need, what kind of livelihood, vocational training. And I think that kind of linkages are important to understand.
Other questions?
Sorry, this is also for Sumita. So you talk a little bit about handicrafts and so I'm going to ask a question about handloom, which is a specific sector and a sector that's actually been recognized as a sector that's dying. And I think one of the things that I'd like you to focus on is the market, essentially, mm-hmm. and the fact that, so we have the Fab India model, for instance, which has tried to take these products to a new consumer. Earlier, handloom was something that was actually locally consumed, right? So everyone wore handloom. Now people wear synthetics because they're easier to maintain, right? So modes of life changing. What is the role of organizations like yours or the ADB in trying to find new consumers for these products, or do we innovate and change the products in order to meet new markets?
Yeah, that's a vast question, actually. Markets are very important. I mean, while I don't like to use the word market-driven for everything that I do, but markets are certainly important. And the co-founders of Rang Sutra, along with me, were actually two weavers who traditionally came from weaving families and then went up to set up, as part of the NGO, organizations of weavers. And that's how the company started to ensure work to these about 150 weavers at that point of time. And the market, you're right, there is a Fab India or an Anokhi or the others who are around there. The market exists, thankfully. Thankfully, the market exists. I mean, whether in, and I'm talking about India, I'm not talking about outside, the market still exists in India for handloom, for handcrafted. And the trick, and the funniest thing is that we started Rang Sutra thinking that marketing is a problem. The weaver said, "Hame dukaan chahiye. We need a shop where we can sell our products." And starting off Rang Sutra, what we realized that the handloom production actually wasn't geared up to cater to the needs of the market. I'm not just talking about changing the composition, the kind of product, but even the kind of handloom that we needed, the quantity, the 150 weavers weren't able to make. So we needed to then find other weavers, we needed to make some changes in the handloom production so that it could be faster. One group of weavers, handloom weavers, also set up a power loom unit because there was a need to create, you know, to cater to this. So to understand your question better, I think both on the market as well as on the production side, there is opportunity, and I don't think the handloom all is lost in the handloom sector. There's a lot of scope for innovation and market there.
One more question here.
Good afternoon. My name is Kavita. Just to understand a little, most of the, I mean, in the forum right now, we were talking about poverty reduction, and most of the stuff I see is that it is very related to the rural in India, but 32% of urban India is below poverty.